5 and a 4 and a 3 and a 2 and a 1. Hello everybody, my name is Delzar, and today I'm, well, a few days late, a few days probably by the time this comes out. Yeah, this is Ample Samuel's, well, summary review and analysis of episodes 9 and 10 of Fiona and Cake. So, I'd like for us to get into this shit because usually it's fucking cool. It's been cool so far, and honestly I don't know what the hell else is happening. Heard a lot of fuckery happen, but I've managed to dodge spoilers. But let's go. Oh yeah, by the way, this is not a market substitute. Take your ass to the original, you know, video in the description of this and find it. Also, if you're trying to watch this only so that you can't watch Fiona and Cake when it comes out, what the fuck's wrong with you? Go watch Fiona and Cake. Only reason I'm not going and watching the official episodes right now is because I just want to binge them all after the show's over. But I don't want to be left out because I know for a fact spoilers don't actually hurt my viewing experience. So I do just watch this shit. Anyways, let's get into it.
After what felt like 5 very short weeks, we've finally reached the final 2 episodes of Fiona and Cake. And if you've been anywhere near the internet since very early Thursday morning, you know that people certainly have some opinions on this pair of episodes.
I heard there was some bullshit. I heard people arguing.
For quite some time, let's dive into the new Adventure Time we got last week and discuss what doesn't work in this finale and what ultimately really does.
My name is Simon Petrikov. I'm from another world, far different than your own.
The first few minutes of the episode consists of some really terrific scenes, starting with the somewhat cold open, which is notably not before the title card, as we see a shared nightmare between Fiona and Kate. Besides this scene, just like the rest of the finale,
the world is so fucking pretty. Oh shit, he was there to talk about it as well.
The episode also takes advantage of the fact that it is conceivable that their world would become temporarily magic, as Simon could have temporarily become the Ice King, so it's not entirely immediately obvious that this isn't reality. I appreciate them giving us a chance to see Hunter Wizard's design here, as we never get another opportunity, as the episode dips into the nightmare
part of the illusion, as
we see horrific interpretations of Prince Gumball and Vampire Marshall Lee.
No!
Fiona begins to worry once again about the implications of making people magical again. The most visually striking part is...
No, please! No, my babies! I liked my little fucking mask. Like, I liked Mask Gum. I forgot what his name was. I think it was Gary. I like Gary and I like Marshall Lee. This is not what the fuck I want. What have you done? Fiona, take it back. Take it fucking back. Go to Prismo. Take this shit back. This is fucked.
Sequence comes as the pair make it to their home, as Fiona eerily opens her fridge, building tension before the reveal of a horrifically unsettling depiction of Ice Simon, which fully plants the seed of guilt into Fiona's mind. Anyway, once they get up and have a quick interaction with Tiffany on
so
the ice,
fucked.
Fiona finally learns about her two closest friends being together, and while I do think that this scene could have been a bit longer, it's still a cute reveal as she revels in the moment. Anyway, as Gary and Marshall learn and come to terms with the whole we're all in some old guy's head and cake is magic and soon everybody else will be too thing, we get to see what's going on with the rest of that old guy's body in what easily becomes the best scene in this half of the finale.
Wait,
as
what?
Simon slowly learns exactly where he is, first seeing the
lich
in a turn that I honestly wasn't sure was actually coming, but was heavily appreciated. Seeing Adventure Time's most iconic true villain on his knees talking about losing his one and only purpose is initially such an odd scene, but that train of thought is ended by the reveal of who we all knew was coming, the one and only Gold. And man, is every single shot of this character throughout all 44 minutes absolutely terrific.
That's fucking scary as shit.
Of the character's condition, with the character movements feeling deeply uncomfortable as she stares down Simon and the Lich. Of course, watching the only successful Lich in the series and the one responsible for the death of at least some version of every single character we loved in the first 4 seasons, being completely demolished by her also further entrenches the idea that Gold Betty has truly become powerful beyond...
Wait, does that mean that every single one of those blocks of cubes is a lich? In which, holy fuck, that is actually a very small amount of... That's a really small amount of them, actually. Now that I think about it. I thought there would be a lot more liches that succeeded.
Recognition. As the lich's final state implies that he isn't the first scholar of Golb to get this treatment. In general, I really like how the lich is used in this episode. As by making him less mechanical, they highlight how truly visually emotionless Betty has become. Despite this, we get a really heartfelt conversation between the god and her former fiancé at this point, which is obviously just Simon talking, as he apologizes for what he did to Betty, telling her about how meeting Fiona and Cake has finally given him purpose for living again, as
god
he prepares to lay down his life for them just like Betty did for him. It's such a fantastic scene that I loved so, so much. And this is where the finale first starts to dip for a bit.
Nope.
As Betty interrupts him as we jump thousands of years into the future to meet back up with Shermie and Beth, who continue their come along with me tradition of crashing Adventure Time finales, as we see them pull Finn and Jake style shenanigans in the Gibbon Rule puppet.
Come along with me. Don't you see how I don't believe it?
Come along with me. Been on board with the idea of don't them getting the next Adventure Time spinoff, them being in such a huge.
By the way, sorry, I can't help it. I'm listening. What the fuck else did it say? Gibeon sucks. Nah. Just fucking a whole bunch of red tape and bullshit just drawn all over this. It's fucking cute.
Huge chunk of this finale that feels kind of rushed at parts otherwise in such a way that honestly...
Revolution. Praxis. What? Find comrades. Buy spray paint. Spread word. Form guerrilla force. Kick Gibeon's butt.
Like a backdoor pilot is tough to stomach. Anyway, to quickly go through the rest of their plot for the episode, Golb
Betty is a cool looking sword.
Simon's mind into the body of Shermie, who first freaks out with some great voice acting, I might add, and then goes with Beth, who thinks he's just joking around, to a library to try and find some information on the ground. And even if you want to argue that Simon becoming Shermie is symbolic for reasons I'll get to later in this video, that doesn't
Are these fucking spell guns? Just put the book in the gun?
Simon stuck in Shermie's body, robbing a library, and fighting pagelings with Beth any less boring and out of place in a finale like this. As I mentioned at the top, this episode features title cards done in the style of the original show, something that is reflected in the Simon Shermie and Beth shenanigans feeling like a regular, somewhat low-stakes episode of the base Adventure Time. Once the pair get back to the reading tree, there are suddenly a few more things that I really like. As Shermie Simon crying at the thought of not being able to save Fiona and Cake is a really nice moment that's only slightly hurt by the goofiness of the situation. Their plot ends with the pair finally getting into the book that Shermie found about the crown, only for it to reveal itself to be a cross between a choose-your-own-adventure book and a PS1-style game about the titular Casper and Nova, who reveal themselves to be metaphorical representations of Simon and Betty rather quickly and rather obviously. Something that really works for this episode.
Sorry, I'm trying to wrap my head around all this because this is a lot of fucking information to process. Number one, beautiful as always. Number two, the fucking game book spell. This is why I love Adventure Time, because they just said fuck everybody else's logic. The internal consistency of this show is amazing. And I'm going to keep gassing it because nostalgia fuels me. You know, it's for liking the video anyways. Let's get into this.
As the Animal Crossing N64 type graphics are really charming. This idea does start to lose its charm in the second half of this pairing, but first we gotta break down what's going on in Fiona world. Once we catch back up to them, Marshall and Gary seem to have gotten over the initial shock of the new and improved Cake, and are instead focused on the idea of them possibly forgetting about each other once the magic hits. A reality that Fiona is unable to confirm, deny, deny or even stumble.
Why would they forget again?
Cake seems more or less indifferent to their struggle, making jokes about how they might end up trying to kill each other like in Vampire World, a moment that more or less confirms that Fiona will be the only one on this side of the portal to get any character development or any kind of arc in these two episodes, as she continues to worry that she's messing everything up. Despite all of my somewhat negativity for especially this half of the finale, I really like Fiona in pretty much all 44 minutes of this thing, as she remains the solid character that the first 8 episodes built her up to be, as hearing of Marshall and Gary's plight causes her to want to go try and find a portal.
Sorry, I was just looking in the background. Why the fuck were there stairs here? There's fucking stairs here. I'm now realizing that y'all can't see it. Give me a damn second. Why the fuck are there stairs? Who fucking uses those stairs? Why are they there? Okay, anyways, I'm gonna hide it again. Just fucking weird shit like that. Just like, why is it there? Who did this?
Marshall and Gary's plight causes her to want to go try and find a portal to try and fix what she thinks she caused.
This is so pretty.
Meanwhile, Scarab, who I'm sure you didn't forget is the actual antagonist of the show, tries to take out Simon while he's in his current state, only for Gold Betty to not exactly take that well, splitting him into smaller and smaller bugs until they are eventually forced to flee, piece by piece, into the Simon portal. As the animation of an angry Gulb is genuinely perfect in showcasing the alien feel of the god as she looks down and protects the incomparably small Simon in front of her. Because of these events, when Fiona opens up the freezer for access to the portal, she instead finds a collection of Scarab beetles who threaten to combine back into their somewhat menacing source as the gang spend the rest of the episode trying to secure them all. I really like the chemistry between Fiona, Cake, Marshall, Gary.
So these things are like, what are they? What the fuck is Scarab's abilities?
At least had a few episodes together, even though some of them have never actually met each other before this point. I like a lot of the animation they use during these scenes with all of the various methods to trap the little Scarabs, and the scene back in Fiona's bedroom where they watch Cheers and talk about how screwed and helpless they are is really nice too. LSP being the one to free the Scarab beetles and ultimately risk the fate of their world truly makes it feel like Lumpy Space Princess is there herself. And Scarab appearing from behind the flames in the apartment is genuinely the sickest and most imposing the character has been or will be at any point throughout the
series. That actually is cool as fuck.
As the first half comes to a close. Since this episode connects very, very heavily to the second part, I'm going to save my overall thoughts for the end and move into
it's a finale. It makes sense.
Doesn't mention Cheers and yet has the sitcom as its namesake.
You were a wonderful experience.
You were everything.
The first time I watched this finale, sleep deprived at 3 a.m., I really didn't like it. And every time I thought about it or watched a chunk of it again, I just kept finding things to dislike. But as I watched it one final time to prepare to write this review and really try to understand what they were going for, I think I
what is this?
Got it. So just in case you're wondering why this review is mostly positive when the first half of this video kind of made it sound like it wasn't going to, that's why. Anyway, despite my somewhat critical reevaluation of this episode mid-video, no amount of soul searching is going to make this beautifully animated cold open of Casper and Nova that continues throughout.
Also, by the way, yeah, no, these are genuinely some fucking cute and lovely designs. Yeah, there's definitely art of them now. It's been over 24 hours. There's too much fucking art on the internet now.
Various long scenes.
But also, what the fuck are they fighting against?
Overly hand-holdy. From like a minute into their appearance in the last episode, it becomes clear that they are a representation of the idea that Betty and Simon's relationship wasn't perfect, on the basis that Betty was constantly making sacrifices that Simon was woefully unaware of. Despite this, and the fact that the idea has been touched on both in the original series, like in Temple of Mars, and in Fiona and Cake back in Jerry, this episode still feels the need to beat this idea into us, as it's made clearer and more obvious over and over and over again. And I don't want to give the idea that I dislike this direction of the plot, as I'm going to praise it extensively in like a paragraph and a half, but in a show meant for adults, this plot point still could have been more subtle. Also, while there are a few good jokes in here, I still think that, while a neat appearance, Beth and Shermie just didn't need to be in this episode, as it really only comes into play when Beth assumes that Jeremy doesn't understand the intricacies of Casper and Nova's or Betty and Simon's relationship because he's a child, when it's really because Simon views his past romance with childlike innocence instead of how it truly was. And yeah, this point is really cool, and when it clicked in my head, I was immediately impressed with how the show weaved that in, but it still wasn't worth all of this screen time, even with the inclusion of the fantastically named Pawn Swan. At this point, Shermie and Beth say goodbye until their likely inevitable spinoff as we get back to Fiona World, where the Scarab is certainly scarabbing it up.
And yeah. Come on, at least be one little bit of miss.
You can probably guess how I feel about Scarab in this episode.
He's the usual letdown.
Great. He becomes such a goofy villain that he's impossible to take seriously. And while I wish there was some kind of thematic link between him and Fiona, like between the Collector and Luce in the Owl House finale, there's just not. Still, while I don't exactly like the Scarab in this one, I like a lot of the stuff happening around him. The visuals with him destroying the town Cake turning into Godzilla is such a fun way for her to contribute to the fight, and the jokes throughout, while perhaps a bit overkill, are always funny. Especially with Gary and Marshall trying to use baked goods and songs respectively.
Oh, fucking hell, that's this horrifying face.
So, yeah, while the Scarab isn't...
Oh, never mind, he's not as scary. When his mask is all fucked up, that looks scary, but his actual face is pretty chill. Also, Jesus, this reminds me of a fucking Twitter thing I saw recently. Someone made some shit in Blender that basically does the same effect. Anyways, fucking reality erasure is great. It's power.
He lets down as a villain pretty consistently, especially with the dumb scene with everybody coming out of the eggs and revealing that he trapped them for petty reasons. I still think this scene is pretty good, and sets up two scenes that I initially disliked, but ultimately found myself really, really appreciating the third time around. As Simon returns to his own body, he begins to have a conversation with Golbet that's not easy on the heartstrings, as he starts to ponder back to that day at the bus stop and what steps he could have taken differently. And while this video was originally going to feature me going on and on about how dumb it is for Simon to talk about what he could have done to not find the crown when we literally saw how much everything sucked in the vampire world without an Ice King, that's not the point of this scene. Simon realizing that his relationship wasn't perfect isn't the point of the scene either. Throughout the entirety of the season, it's clear that Simon was going to have to value his own life at some point in the show as he comes to the conclusion to not put on the crown. And while the show could have had him come to this conclusion in a dozen different ways, the way it chooses to do this is by Betty pointing out to Simon.
Sorry, I'm being really quiet right now because I'm trying to get every bit of information before I start trying to put in input, but I need to save this at least one. Uses so many fucking versions of red. It's beautiful. Even when it just tells you, hey, this is basically an old scene. Also, god damn, the amount of emotional complexity that would have to go through someone's head as you are constantly just drifting there and just thinking, the fuck do I do?
That while he loved her and she loved him and he appreciated her, he never fully understood and therefore appreciated the depths of the sacrifices she constantly made for him, with the ultimate one being her becoming Golbetti to save him and his mind. Simon going back in the flashback and trying to change this event isn't really about him wishing that he went on her expedition. It's about him wishing that he had just approached their relationship differently in general. And by suddenly reevaluating Betty's biggest sacrifice, Simon realizes how much she truly valued his life and how awful it would be towards her past if he threw it all away and just put on the crown again anyway. But really, that's only part of why this works.
Also, Crucifix, I know you were trying, didn't you say you weren't going to watch, you were going to watch this later? I'm sorry for giving you spoilers. I wish you hadn't just run your ass in here.
So well, as the true reason that Simon didn't value his own life in the first place,
it's all good. Okay.
He couldn't stop thinking about all of his mistakes in the past. He just couldn't find acceptance for what had happened and what he did in response, fueling both his self-hatred and his willingness to give up his ability to think about the past and become the Ice King once again. But what Betty helps him do, even in her incomprehensible God state, is allow him to begin moving on from the past. Symbolized through the flashback fading away, Simon throwing the crown into the abyss, and ultimately the separation of Fiona World, a representation of the Ice King's mania as he moves on to focus on the future. It definitely took me multiple rewatches of the scene to fully grasp and appreciate everything that it goes for. But as I just spent a few minutes talking about, I really love how they chose to wrap up Betty and Simon's story, as he learns to appreciate his life and Betty's sacrifices, and to stop obsessing over the unchangeable past. Assuming that we never get another story so focused on these two characters, I'm glad we got one final goodbye, as Simon sees one last glimpse of his love, as she seemingly morphs into something we may never see the full consequences of. And after a casual canonization of Water Park Prank, Simon is left in a field to break down everything that just happened. Meanwhile, Fiona receives two different phone calls from Simon while she's dealing with the chaos of her namesake world. And as Simon chaotically offers one final time to become the Ice King and save their world in the middle of everything I just talked about, Fiona declines, finally accepting her world as the way it is and mirroring Simon's journey towards acceptance as well.
She chose death.
What better way to represent this change in mindset than Simon taking the now separated Fiona world and giving it to her in the form of a dandelion. As, just like in the first episode, she once again wishes for her world to change. And although this time is silent, it's more than clear what she desires. It's a really beautiful end to the series, as Fiona accepts her world for what it is, and decides that she needs to take partial ownership of it if she wants it to become better. And there's still 10 minutes left. Since I've spent a few minutes being positive,
you're right, there is 10 minutes left.
It's
the fuck?
Time for me to be negative again.
Oh boy,
everything
no.
Everything in Fiona World after this point ranges from okay to some of the most puzzling decisions.
Oh no, Scarab is left there. Damn it, he should die.
At this point, Scarab's rampage is stopped by a comedic phone dropping in from the boss, who tells him that his powers no longer work to destroy the world, as Fiona World has become canonized. A nice callback to the fanfiction nature of Fiona and Cake. In response to this news, Scarab literally decides to throw a temper tantrum that's stopped by Prismo summoning Baby Finn and Pep Tank from Fiona World, the squirrel from Ew, and just as I somewhat predicted, Little Destiny and
what
Jay,
the fuck?
What I'm currently calling my favorite episode of the series, but that's in jeopardy after the pair make the
monster they're fucking cute as hell.
To just stay in Fiona World after this fight. I'm getting ahead of myself a little, but it just bothers me so much.
It's fanfiction given life.
Willingly leave his world in good spirits and making jokes about toilets when he has recently orphaned little siblings back at home.
I believe this plot point. He does have siblings.
So many writers. years, and is by far the least excusable aspect of the finale. Even if Farmworld Finn is still alive because of his hat made for vampires or whatever, this moment is still so awkward and just left such a sour taste in my mouth. Fiona turning giant with the squirrel strawberries in her biggest fantasy is a fun moment in this painfully unnecessary scene. And while I do like her getting to defeat the Scarab herself after Gol Betty was really the one who saved her world, her acceptance of not being magic, followed by her growing huge with magic, doesn't exactly quite fit thematically. I just don't really think this big action scene helps the finale more than it ultimately lets it down, as I would have loved the soft, dialogue-centric ending that it looked like we were going to get. But ultimately, just like Simon and Fiona learn in this episode, all you can do is accept the unchangeable past that the last third or so of this episode could definitely be better. And with that,
it seemed like this was a really promising series, but if it started so well, ended off kind of meh.
Who made the decision to use their
to be
song,
fair, at least it did keep up like so much until then.
Seriously, so many options here could have been better, as they literally could have just used the extended Everything in You or the Cheers theme, or just something else that actually sounds like Adventure Time, but instead we get a song that they couldn't even be bothered to put on the soundtrack. Anyway, enough about that.
Damn.
I do mostly like what's actually happening in this montage, as we get a variety of hilarious circumstances of the newly hodgepodge reality of Fiona World, with the best scene here having to be Fiona and Marshall protesting for better rent, as the Fiona World equivalent of the Lord of the Underworld being a landlord is never not going to be funny. We also get some Simon stuff here, and while I do think
we need better rent.
Other scenes,
yeah,
I would have ended
you're never getting better
him
rent.
Him going to therapy as a literal joke, Simon embracing Astrid as well as future technology is a nice touch. Also, we see what ultimately happens with the Scarab, as he becomes 2D just like Prismo, which is a goofy punishment for the goofy character they wrote him into. Moving on to something more positive, the final scene of
actually kind of like that one,
and probably Fiona and Cake as a series is such a.
If it had been up to me, I would have had her come in immediately with the big action scene. Her realizing that the Scarab can't fucking just be defeated easily, and saying, fuck it, we're gonna make the world not magical, really. And then she blows out the fucking dandelion. I feel like it could have been better if you just rearranged the scenes.
Though
I haven't actually seen it, so who knows?
But to use it as the thumbnail, as she continues to appreciate her world the way that it is, instead of how it was when Simon was the Ice King. In general, while I'll have more to say about the finale in about 2 weeks when I do my season overview, these episodes are best viewed when you don't focus on what's not in the episode. When I describe a Fiona and Cake finale that has no Marceline and Simon, no Huntress Wizard, doesn't reveal Prismo's boss, doesn't utilize the fact that Fiona and Cake were infecting the world and making things non-magic, and lacks the big gut punch of a moment that other finales of Adventure Time have had, you can convince yourself that this finale sucks. But when I describe a finale that is impeccably well animated, really funny, has complex and cleverly implemented themes,
don't take it so damn seriously, man. It's a fucking fanfiction world. There's gonna be potholes everywhere.
Understanding their relationship better and appreciating his own life as a result, and a finale that wraps up and ties together Fiona and Simon's arc to the theme of acceptance in a way that took me multiple viewings to properly understand, and you have a finale that ultimately feels like nothing else in animation, and thus will always be received very differently by different people who were lucky enough to watch this series. Anyway, that's about it for me. Thank you.
You know
so
how it is. I will link everything in the description, as usual.
With me on this fantastic journey with Fiona.
And then I'm gonna get the fuck out of here and bounce.
As it was the biggest month ever for Ample in both content produced and viewership, a fact for which I'm deeply grateful. As I mentioned before,
and honestly, Ample Samuel deserves it.
Tour to Jump City for the first video of October. I still have one more wrap-up video for Fiona and Cake planned. We're going to rank the episodes, rank the songs, and just kind of generally talk about my thoughts on the show as a whole.
I would love to see this when it comes out.
If you want me to mention that video, leave it down in the comments. Either way,
I don't think I have anything.
And going through Fiona and Cake with you guys is truly an experience I won't soon forget. Thanks for watching.
Everyone, please, get into the description of this video, find the original link, and watch it. Just do it, okay? I don't think I need to actually tell you why, but yeah, do that. I don't even feel like plugging myself. See you. Have a lovely day.